Greetings and welcome to part three of our three-part video series on how we go about creating a VMware infrastructure for our network. Now, before we get started with creating our last server, which is the ESXi server, we're going to talk about some of the fundamentals about installing vCenter and or ESXi. First off, there are some requirements that you just have to have in place before you can install vCenter or ESXi. The primary thing that I found is the memory. If you try to install vCenter, you're going to need at least 8 gigabytes of available RAM. In conjunction with that, the ESXi server needs another 4 gigabytes of RAM. Now, you also have to have a domain controller or at least a DNS server running on your network. I have a domain controller for my lab that I'm using right now that runs DNS, and so I am pointing vCenter, and I will be pointing the ESXi server over to that domain controller so that it can find DNS. But that's another requirement. Another requirement is that both of them must be statically configured with an IPv4 address. So make sure that you understand the requirements before you dive into installing vCenter or the ESXi. A couple more troubleshooting tips before we get started. First off, I found that Internet Explorer was just too problematic for me to use with the vCenter. So what I did was I downloaded and I installed Firefox ESR. That allowed me to go out and download the Adobe Flash Player, which is a requirement for the vCenter management console to work inside of a browser. So I got around that by doing what I just told you. The second thing is what you see here on the desktop, that is presented to you by a little tool called BGInfo. It's a free download from the Microsoft people, and it's great for identifying servers, especially if you got a whole bunch of servers, or if you're jumping around from server to server and you get confused about, hey, where am I at right now? Because sometimes we even forget to look up here inside of the tabs. I know I do. So this is nice to have right here on my desktop, and it's got all my information, such as the IP address configuration. It's got the amount of RAM that I've got here. So this is all just nicely displayed for me. So to get started here, I'm just going to go up to my VMware Workstation Pro. I'm going to click on File, and I'm going to go to New Virtual Machine. That's going to launch the new Virtual Machine Wizard. We're going to select Custom. I'm going to say Next. And from here, we're going to pull this down. We're going to select Workstation 10. And from here, we'll see that this is compatible with my ESXi server that we're going to be installing, which is the 6.5 version. I'm going to go ahead and say next to that. So I'm now going to browse on over and get my install for the ESXi server. I'm just going to double click that. And I'll say next to that. Now it wants me to give it a name. I'm just going to call it ESXi. We can call it 6.0 if we like. I'm going to go ahead and say next to that. We got to have at least 2 processors. We're going to leave that alone. The memory has to be at least 4 gigabytes. We're going to leave that alone. And we're going to use the network address translation. Now, you can use Bridge, but in this case, I'm going to go ahead and use NAT. I'm going to go ahead and say next to that. And we're going to leave the default for the LSI logic. I'm going to go ahead and leave the default for a SCSI virtual disk. I'm going to go ahead and create a new virtual disk. And we're going to leave that at 60 gigs. I don't want a 40 gig because I'm going to run out of space for this lab if I do that. We're also going to select the radio button for using a single disk. Click next to that. Now I have to give it a friendly name, that is to say the disk file, and I have to tell you where I want to save it. I don't want to save this at the root of my C drive, so I'm going to push this on over to one of my storage areas. So I'm going to save this disk over to my secondary storage up inside of a folder called VMware Images inside of a secondary folder called ESXi, and we're going to leave the default name as it is. I'm going to go ahead and say next to that. Now I can look at everything and make sure I have everything configured correctly. If you need to customize the hardware, you can click here. I'm going to go ahead and say finish. So right away we see that the boot installer pops up. We can go ahead and accept the default. All you got to do is just hit enter or just wait and it'll start up by itself and let it roll on. Be patient with the installation. It can take just a little while. So if you want to go do something else, like get a cup of coffee, watch a little TV, this is a good time to do it. We can go ahead and hit enter. And we can hit F11 to accept the license agreement. And now we're going to scan for all available devices. And it comes up and it tells me what it's found. We're going to go ahead and hit enter again. And we're going to use US default for the keyboard layout. Now, remember your root password. This is very important. Don't forget this. All right. So whatever you type in here, it's going to have to be used when you want to log on or log into your ESXi server. So I'm going to go ahead and type that in real quick. Once the passwords match up, we can go ahead and hit enter. And again, we're scanning the system. Confirm the install. The installer is configured to install the ESXi 600 series. We're going to go ahead and hit F11, and there we go. All right, so the installation has successfully completed. We're now ready to reboot. I'm just going to go ahead and hit enter, and it's going to reboot. We will be back up and running with our EXI server in just a moment. The EXI server has rebooted, and we're back up to this limited management console here. There's not a whole lot you can do here, but pay attention to that IP address down there in the yellow. This is what it wants to do. It wants to grab an IP address from your DHCP server, which is fine, except that we need to configure one statically. Now, to do this, we need to get into the limited functionality of the management console itself. To do this, we're going to hit F2. And now we have to type in our root, which is our default name. Now we're going to type in our password. This is the password that we configured during the installation. Now I can hit F2 one more time, and we're into the limited functionality. So you can see that we have some ability to configure a new password. Don't mess around with that. Configure the lockdown mode. You don't need to play around with that. Configure the network management network. Restart the management network, test the management network, and network restore options. Configure the keyboard, and there's some other options that we can play around here with. So we're now ready to go ahead and configure a static IP address for our ESXi server. To do this, I'm just using my arrows, and I've scrolled on down to where it says configure management network. I'm going to hit enter to that. Now I'm going to use my arrows again. I'm going to go down to where it says IP4 configuration. Hit enter. Now you have to read everything that's on this screen. You'll see that right now it's disabled IP4 configuration for management network. And I'm going to go down here and I'm going to select the option for set a static IP4 address and network configuration. Now use your space bar to go ahead and check that. Then you can hit enter for OK. Now I can also at this time just scroll on down one more level to the IP4 address. And I can get in there and I can change that. So I'm going to go ahead and hit enter here. Or I can just start typing. Now make sure you put your doc. You can now scroll on down to your default gateway. I'm going to go ahead and change that as well. Now I check everything to make sure it's okay. And I'm going to go ahead and hit enter for okay. Brings me back out. Now I'm going to go ahead and escape. But before we do that, I see one more thing we need to configure, and that's the DNS. So we're going to go ahead and configure our DNS settings while we're in here. So I'm going to select DNS and go ahead and hit enter. And that primary DNS is actually correct, so I don't have to do anything with it. So I can go ahead and escape. Brings me back out. I can hit escape one more time. And now it wants to apply the changes and restart the management network. I will say Y for yes. So we're now back at the default management window for my new ESXi server. And we're now ready to figure out a way to try to access it. And we got two different ways. We can use a web browser or we can use the Windows client. So we're going to start off with the web browser. So I'm going to go back over here to my vCenter. We're just going to open up a browser. Everybody's on the same network. So up here inside this browser, I'm just going to type in http://// the IP address of my new ESXi server. Now, once I tell it to go, there's going to be a problem with the connection not being secure. For this, we're just going to hit the advanced button right here. We're going to add an exception. And now all we have to do is just confirm the exception. And there we are. But it will work if you have a host machine such as a Windows 7 or a Windows 8 or a Windows 10 on your network and you want to use the client to manage your EXI server remotely, then that's how you do it. What we're going to do is we're going to move ahead and we're going to use vCenter. So I'm going to go ahead and close out this browser here. And what we're going to do is we're going to open up vCenter. And do this, I've already got it installed on here, so I'm just going to go up here to my bookmarks. I'm going to scroll on down till I come to vCenter web client. I'm going to log into my vCenter, and then we're going to import the EXI server that we built. Before we can add our new EXXI server to our vCenter, we need to create a database. So to do this, I've got the tab here selected for host and clusters. I'm just going to right click on this. I'm going to select new data center. We're going to give our data center a user-friendly name. Now, normally we would build this on something such as functionality, location, something that makes it easy to recognize where all of these virtual machines are located. So I'm going to call this Tucson, and I'm going to say okay to that. Now I have a database that's called Tucson. So if I had a global enterprise and I had virtual machines scattered all over the globe, I could organize them up here inside of vCenter based on their location. Now that I have my data center, our next step is just to add a host. So I'm going to click on Add Host, and I can type in either the host name or the IP address. I'm going to go ahead and type in the IP address because I know that'll work. And now it wants my root and my password. So remember, the username for that machine is root, and then that password that we created during the installation. Say next, give it a chance to validate. Now you're going to get this certificate error because this is a private certificate, and so it's not from a trusted certificate source. So just go ahead and say yes. And now we have the host summary. Click next again. We're evaluating the license, and says that the license expires in 60 days. That's fine. Say next to that. We're going to leave it disabled. That is to say, the lockdown. We don't want to mess with that. We're going to go say next. The VM location is in Tucson. We're going to say next to that. And we're ready to complete. And we're going to click Finish. You can watch the status down here inside of your recent task. And you can watch it complete. Now, if anything happens down here, then you'll get an error message. That concludes a short video presentation on how we go about adding an ESXi server to our vCenter console. Hope you found this video informative. And if you have any questions,